Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for this month's Behind the Breakthrough program. Today, we will focus on Dana-Farber's work to uncover promising new therapies for lung cancer patients. My name is Bill Gillen, and I've had the pleasure of serving as a Dana-Farber trustee for the past 16 years. And each time I participate in these forums, I am always inspired by the dedication of the brilliant minds that are working so diligently to find therapies and cures for those battling cancer, and I know you will too. We're privileged to have with us today several leaders from Dana-Farber's Lowe Center for Thoracic Oncology, who are at the forefront of the field, developing treatments that focus on specific needs for each patient. These discoveries are translating into more patients living longer and healthier lives. We would like this program to be interactive, so I would welcome everyone to please write in the chat area where you are tuning in from today to kick us off. And in order to do that, for those of you that aren't familiar, you click on the chat button at the lower part of your screen. Looks like a dialogue box. That will open up a message box. You can type in where you're tuning in from, and remember to hit enter in order to send that message. While everyone's doing that, I'd like to share a few housekeeping notes. Please note that all attendees are on mute and their cameras are turned off to ensure everyone can adequately hear the program. Should you have questions throughout today's program, we encourage you to use the chat icon on the bottom of your screen, and we'll have time to address these questions after we hear from our speakers and panelists today. I now have the great pleasure to introduce Dr. Pasi Jänne. Dr. Jänne is the director of Dana-Farber's Lowe Center for Thoracic Oncology, Robert and Renee Belfer Center for Applied Cancer Science, and the Chen Huang Center for EGFR mutant lung cancers. His main research interests include studying the therapeutic relevance of genetic alterations in lung cancer. He also co-discovered EGFR mutations and has led the development of therapeutic strategies for patients with EGFR mutant lung cancer. Most recently, Dr. Jänne was selected as the laureate of the 50th Griffel Award by the ARC Foundation for Cancer Research in France for his work in EGFR mutant lung cancer. The award is one of the most prestigious prizes in the field of cancer research in Europe and honors researchers whose work has led to a major breakthrough in basic, translational, or clinical oncology research. Dr. Jänne was also named an inductee into the 2021 Giants of Cancer Care program. This honor celebrates the achievements of leading researchers and educators whose discoveries have helped propel the field of oncology and establish the building blocks for future advances. Our patients are truly fortunate to have such a world leader at the helm of the thoracic program. Dr. Jänne today will provide us with an overview of the latest priorities and advances of the Lowe Center, and then we'll move to a panel discussion with several other leading experts from the center. Dr. Jänne.
Thank you so much, Bill, for that kind introduction. And thank you for all that you have done and continue to do for our program and for the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. So I will give a bit of an overview of the program. And again, I encourage all of you to ask questions in the chat when we'll have time for Q&A at the following my presentation or and following the panel discussion. So let me just share my slides here. Okay, so I wanted to give an overview of our program and highlight some of the priorities of our program, and again, just to kind of bring everyone to the same page. So this is the outline of what I'll talk about: our center's mission and scope, accomplishments and areas of opportunity, our mission through a patient story, which we'll see a video at the end of, and discussion with our center leaders, which will be our panel discussion. So the mission of our center is to deliver the most innovative treatment options available to patients with all stages of lung and thoracic malignancies, provide exceptional care from world-class specialists in an environment that supports the needs of patients and their families, and personalized lung tumor therapies at the heart of our treatment philosophy. What is the importance of our work? Well, lung cancer is the second most common cancer diagnosed in the United States, second to prostate cancer in men and breast cancer for women. However, lung cancer still remains as the most common cause of cancer death for both men and women in the United States. It accounts for 25% of all cancer deaths in the US, and that's greater than breast, colon, and prostate cancers combined. And lung cancer mainly occurs in those over the age of 65, although we see lung cancers in young patients as well, and I'll mention that a little bit later on. So just about our clinic in general, this just shows you kind of our clinical growth over the last few years. Of course, in-person clinical visits were not as common in FY20 or FY21 due to COVID, and we did a lot of virtual visits. This is only in-person visits, but shows sort of steady growth of the program. And FY22 is here on the right-hand side, which is tracking nicely. Some of you know, we have a second campus at Chestnut Hill, which is at the old Atrium Mall, has been converted into medical offices. And our program has a fairly large presence there and see patients and provide therapy there as well. And so we have sort of two places where we see patients at the main site, which we call the Yawkey Center, and then at Chestnut Hill. So some of the areas of focus for us as a program, excuse me, and I'll go through these in detail. Number one is targeted therapies. Those therapies that target the specific genetic uniquenesses or alterations that are found in individuals' cancers that Bill mentioned, the EGFR in the introduction. And we want to figure out what to do or are keenly interested in figuring out how to tackle the issue of when those therapies that are quite effective, when they stop working, and how do we overcome or prevent it from happening in the first place. And we can also have, at the same time, developing strategies to monitor how cancers evolve in response to therapies through a sort of serial blood-based analyses. The second sort of hallmark of therapies for lung cancer and for many cancers these days is immune therapy. And many of you, I'm sure you are familiar with this or see advertisements on it on TV. And this has been a significant improvement for many of our patients. And we're trying to understand how do you improve upon that, because it doesn't work in everybody. And how do you ultimately predict who it's going to work when, and if it stops working again, why does it stop working, and how can we leverage that information? And finally, just new areas of therapies. We'll hear a little bit about KRAS-directed therapies today, but different types of therapies that are being employed, personalized vaccines, antibody drug conjugates, which are proteins essentially used to specifically deliver chemotherapy to tumor cells, use of all of these therapies before and after surgery for patients with earlier stages of lung cancer. So really incorporating the effective therapies into earlier stages of disease is also another large area for us. So this is on the bottom right here is often the pie chart that we talk to patients and our colleagues about, and shows kind of when we think about lung adenocarcinoma, which is the most common type of lung cancer, sort of the breakdown of the unique genetic alterations in those cancers. Bill mentioned EGFR, which in the US is found in about 10 to 15% of patients, KRAS, which is found in about a quarter of individuals, and all these other alterations shown here. And what we have done and continue to do is to look for these alterations in individuals' cancers using sequencing, extensive sequencing analyses. And we were the first center at the Dana-Farber to adapt this clinically. And you can see on the left sort of how many patients we sequenced in 2021. And sometimes we can do the sequencing from the blood, not from the tumor, as a surrogate. The reason we look for these alterations is because at the moment, there are seven of these alterations have specific drug approvals, and sometimes more than one drug approval. And we want to match the most effective therapy to the patient's cancer that's most likely to be vulnerable to that therapy. And that has turned out to be successful clinically. we do other type of sequencing, which is called germline sequencing. That's not sequencing the tumor, that's sequencing the host, the individual, to sometimes understand why cancer may have developed in that individual. But sometimes these alterations in the host genetics may impact also how we would best treat the individual's cancer as well. So that's more of a growing area or a new direction that we're taking on. And as mentioned, we do what are called liquid biopsies, which are sequencing from the blood. Tumors shed their genetic material into the blood, and we can use that to our advantage to look for these alterations in the blood. We can look at mutational signatures, and we are starting to do more comprehensive, what we call immune profiling, which is to look at really understand the immune microenvironment in a systematic manner in individuals' tumors, which we believe will be helpful in guiding current and future immune therapies moving forward. So what's the outcome of all this? Well, I think the good news that I want to share with everyone is that we are making progress in lung cancer. There are a couple of studies that have looked at this. This was a study published in 2020 in the New England Journal of Medicine, where they looked at showed that the incidence of lung cancer is decreasing both men and women, which is a good thing. And what was termed incidence-based mortality, meaning death from lung cancer, was declining even faster. And that was because people were living longer with lung cancer, which is a good thing. And when they went and did this analysis, this sort of inflection point of when that happened was around the time when we started to do the comprehensive genetic testing, when we started to have the first use of an EGFR inhibitor as initial treatment for that subset of individuals who have the EGFR mutant lung cancer. So we do think that matching what's going on in the tumor to the most effective therapy is the right thing to do. It's making a difference. And this doesn't even include the impact of the other multiple targeted therapies that have been approved or the immune therapy. So we think that this will continue to improve. And earlier this year, the American Cancer Society, which puts out statistics on lung cancer and other cancers every year, also had a similar conclusion that improvements have been made. In red is lung cancer. You can see it by men, it's going down, and women's going down. Screening, which is to detect lung cancer at an early stage in individuals who are high risk, was first or approved or suggested in 2013, and we think it's made an improvement in curing more individuals. And you can see in the bottom of those numbers, but less individuals are diagnosed with metastatic disease because of that. So it's both therapies and screening that we think is making a difference. And which we're very grateful to, and are able to, of course, see that in our patients who are diagnosed with lung cancer and are living with their lung cancer for oftentimes for many, many years living good quality lives. So we're happy that we're also, as a group, been able to contribute to this. And this slide has a list of medicines on the top that were approved for use by the Food and Drug Administration in 2021. And we as a group have contributed to the approval of these medicines by having those clinical trials available for our patients, enrolling patients into the trial and playing roles in these trials. Two of them were for a subtype of EGFR mutant lung cancer, the EGFR exon 20, and one was for KRAS mutant lung cancer, KRAS G12C. And these other medicines on the bottom, again, similarly, we've had big roles as a group in these studies. These are medicines that have received what's called the breakthrough designation from the Food and Drug Administration, which means that they are showing promise with the hope that they will lead to regulatory approval. And the breakthrough designation allows the Food and Drug Administration and the sponsor who makes these drugs to have sort of more efficient conversations and faster review of their of the data to hopefully garner approval. And we do think that at least some of them, adagrasib and trastuzumab deruxtecan, will likely receive regulatory approval either in 2022 or early 2023. So again, more options for patients, and again, we're happy to have played a part in it as a group. So just to give you an idea of our of our program, we have roughly 17 medical oncologists, and most of our oncologists who see patients do other things as well. That 17 only translates to 5.5 full-time individuals. And that's because our investigators either have wet research laboratories like myself, or dry laboratories. They do clinical research or clinical investigation. They have administrative roles or other roles within the institution. We're also supported by a number of nurse practitioners and program nurses who help us with our patients in clinic and help with questions or concerns that arise from our patients. And then we have a large research staff that helps with all of our very important clinical trials and helps get those through the system and helps help with us enrolling patients and all the data management for that. And that requires research nurses, managers, regulatory coordinators, research coordinators. And then we have what are called research genomic specialists, who are individuals who help with all of our correlative science studies and consenting our patients to correlative science studies, including blood-based studies or other tumor-based studies, which without this group, much of our research efforts in moving some of these things forward would not be possible. So we're grateful for that staff. So that gives everyone sort of an understanding of the size of our staff. Excuse me. So what are the sort of the greatest areas of greatest opportunity for us moving forward? Well, I think there are a couple of things, and sort of this idea of preventing or delaying the emergence of drug resistance. We have effective therapies for many subsets of lung cancer, but we're always limited by this problem that the cancers always figure out a way to get around the drug. And we'd like to be smarter than the cancers and develop strategies to prevent that from happening by studying these in model systems and then ultimately taking these hypotheses and observations into the clinic and using, you know, evaluating them through clinical trials to see, were our hypotheses correct, and did the individuals benefit like we thought they would benefit, and if so, great. If not, then why? And then go back and try to reformulate, or, you know, refocus our hypotheses. Sort of expanding the scope of immune therapies. Our current immune therapies, as I mentioned, do work in a subset of lung cancers, but there are lots of different approaches under evaluation. Things like vaccines or cellular therapies, or sometimes called CAR therapies, that you may have heard of, that are not quite there yet for lung cancer. Neither one of them are, but I think it offers an opportunity of moving an area that's promising in other disciplines of oncology into lung cancer. And then the last is this understanding of germline genetic changes. How do they contribute to the development or treatment of lung cancer? This is looking at the genetics of the host. Are there things in one's germline that make them at higher risk for development of lung cancer, which of course has implications for potentially them and their family members? And potentially, does that alteration impact the treatment of lung cancer like it has, for example, in breast and ovarian cancers in individuals who carry alterations in the BRCA gene that has implications for both family members as well as treatment of the specific cancer. And it's an area that really hasn't been explored in lung cancer, and we're focusing initially on studying young patients with lung cancer, young being less than 45, because that is kind of an outlier population that we don't normally think about as getting lung cancer, but we actually see a fair number of individuals in that age group, and we're specifically studying those individuals to again try to understand if we can learn something more that we can then use for to refine our therapeutic and treatment approaches. So just to go over the mission of the center one last time: deliver the most innovative treatment options available to patients with all stages of lung and thoracic malignancies, provide exceptional care from world-class specialists in an environment that supports the needs of patients and their families. And as I mentioned, personalized lung cancer therapy is at the heart of our treatment philosophy. It's what we've been doing for the last 15 years, and it's what we'll continue to do moving forward. Again, matching the therapy that we think is most likely to benefit based on understanding of what is most likely to be effective based on what's happening in the individual's cancer. So with that, I'll stop and we're going to watch a video, and I think Sarah is getting that going.
I'm a runner. I just did an ultra marathon, a 50-mile race, but had persistent pain. I thought it was related to that, but it wasn't. My primary care did a MRI of my hip and saw that there was a pretty big mass in there. She said, so you have lung cancer.
I don't think in 2004 we appreciated the magnitude of the discovery. EGFR inhibitors as drugs were being studied as sort of general therapies for patients with all kinds of lung cancer. There were patients whose tumors shrank dramatically, but it wasn't a random subset. There were certain characteristics of those individuals that made them more likely to have that benefit.
I was 39 at the time, two kids, and it was devastating. I honestly thought to myself, I'm gonna die, I can't believe this.
Today, if you are diagnosed with EGFR mutant lung cancer, your first line treatment is an EGFR inhibitor. If someone has an EGFR mutation, they can pretty comfortably tell that individual that there's a very high likelihood of it working, and it will work hopefully for a long period of time.
I then met with Dr. Jänne, who's doing a phase one clinical trial.
You know, we studied her cancer, were able to find the alteration, and then ultimately get her on the right therapy.
Being able to take that pill, I was able to work full time, do the PanMass challenge twice, continue to be there for my family.
For many of these therapies, people can live lives that are relatively normal. It's changed our approach to this disease. The advantage of having our existing therapies, which are successful and people can be on them for many years, is that during that many years, new therapies are constantly being developed. And we do come together as a community. We talk about our work, present our ideas and our successes and our failures, because we can learn from that. I think it breeds new ideas and new momentum moving forward.
I'm here because of Dana-Farber, and I'm grateful for it.
She's doing well, continuing to work, raise a family, which is wonderful to see.
Okay, thank you. Now I would like to, we'll move on to our panel discussion, and I'll call upon each of our panelists to introduce themselves and their role at the Lowe Center. So I'll start with David.
David Barbie. I'm one of the clinical thoracic oncologists and also run a laboratory and co-director of the Belfer Center with Pasi.
And Mark?
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mark Awad. I'm another one of the thoracic medical oncologists. I'm our clinical director for the group, as well as oversee the clinical research efforts within our lung cancer group. It's a pleasure to be with you all here this afternoon.
Chris?
Good afternoon. I'm Chris Lathan. I'm also a thoracic medical oncologist, and I also am the chief clinical access and equity officer at the Dana-Farber, and I run our cancer care equity program.
And then Julia.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. I'm a thoracic medical oncologist and a clinical researcher, so I see patients and clinical trial development, looking forward to talking with everyone.
Great. Thank you all for joining for this panel discussion, and I'll start off by asking some questions. You know, as I talked about in the presentation, you know, we targeted therapy is sort of at the heart of what we do. For one of those pieces of the pie, KRAS, which accounts for about 25% of the population, this has been a particularly challenging one to develop effective drugs, and for many, many years until recently was thought to be an undruggable target. But we're happy that there is now one FDA-approved agent for a subset of KRAS mutant cancers, and we hope a second one by the end of the year. And So hopefully we'll get rid of that term undruggable. So Julia, maybe you can speak to a little bit about the development of KRAS inhibitors and what kind of impact we're seeing in the clinic and what are the or challenges.
Yeah, you know, KRAS inhibitors have been a very exciting space in lung cancer in the last year or two because, as Dr. Yanni had said, this was felt to be an undruggable target. We've known this mutation was there and that it drove lung cancer cells to survive and grow, but it was not possible for a long time to develop drugs that would actually shut down that KRAS and allow us to give patients personalized therapy against this mutation. Almost a year ago to today, we saw the approval of sotorasib, which is a targeted KRAS inhibitor, which works against the most common of the KRAS mutations. We find that in about half of our patients with a KRAS mutation. So this target has now gone from being undruggable to having an effective approved therapy. We've been really happy here at Dana-Farber. We had the clinical trial that looked at using this drug, sotorasib, open here. So we're able to bring it to our patients and get them access to these sorts of cutting edge therapies early. Now, this has transformed in the clinic for our patients with a KRAS mutation. Now we're not just talking about chemotherapy and immunotherapy, but we're also talking about personalized targeted therapy. And that's a big development and lets us, we believe, improve outcomes for our patients when we find this mutation. It's also catalyzed a lot of interest in the field. KRAS is no longer undruggable, and there's been a lot of interest now in developing, building on this advance to create new therapies for KRAS mutant lung cancer. And some areas that are being looked at, including here at our institution, are things like trying to develop novel new KRAS inhibitors. How can we make this drug work better for more patients with a KRAS mutation? Can we do combination-based therapies building on the backbone of a KRAS inhibitor or combined with other types of treatment like immunotherapy? And then can we take this advance for patients with KRAS G12C positive lung cancer, and can we expand it to patients with more different types of KRAS mutations? So we have something for about half our KRAS patients, but what about the other half? What can we do for those patients to bring targeted therapies to that area? And then lastly, now we have a drug, we think about drug resistance. So what are we gonna do for patients if the drug works, but then stops working down the line? Now my colleague, Dr. Awad, will be discussing this as well. So I think we look forward to seeing more developments in the KRAS space, building on this initial foundation of having a drug.
Thanks so much, Julia. Yeah, a lot of excitement in this space. We have a number of clinical trials that are open or about to open in this space, again, testing many of these new compounds. As you alluded to, we do struggle also with KRAS with the emergence of drug resistance. And I'll turn to Dr. Awad, who has done some work in this space, and maybe you can comment on some of this and what you've learned from your studies and how can we use this information to refine our therapeutic approach.
Thanks, Pasi. I think as you and Julia have nicely articulated, this has been a major advance and a major step forward for KRAS mutant lung cancers. One of the challenges that we continue to face is the emergence of acquired resistance to these therapies. So we can often see cancers shrink down and shrink down quite dramatically. And for each individual patient, the duration of that response can be variable. But one of the real challenges that we face is when the cancer starts to regrow or shows up again in a new spot, or a term that we call acquired resistance. And through all of the work that we've done in the past couple of decades with all of our targeted therapies, this is an area that now we can study and understand and hopefully use to develop novel approaches to either try to overcome resistance once it develops or ideally develop better strategies upfront to delay the emergence of resistance. So prior to these KRAS inhibitor drugs, we've had EGFR inhibitors, ALK inhibitors, ROS1, MET inhibitors, and we've been able to learn and understand how resistance develops to some of those pills or those treatments. And that has helped fuel and advance further discoveries and new drug developments. With KRAS, we and others have been working quite hard to understand the limitations of these drugs in terms of, why do they stop working? And typically, one of the challenges we're seeing is that most cancers will develop resistance to these KRAS inhibitors within the first year of starting them. And we've found a few different things. One is that in addition to the original KRAS mutation, typically G12C, the KRAS gene itself can mutate again, right where the drug tries to bind and block, and those new changes or mutations can prevent the drug from binding anymore. We can also see other genes becoming abnormal, which can sort of bypass around the drug. And we had seen some mutations in genes like ALK or BRAF or another gene called MEK and others that kind of work their way around the inhibitor. We can also see that the cancer appearance or the subtype changes under the microscope, for example, from lung adenocarcinoma to a different type of lung cancer called squamous cell carcinoma. So there's not necessarily one type of resistance that develops for all patients. There are very distinct and different types of resistance that can emerge in each individual person. And by understanding resistance, typically by getting a new biopsy at the time the cancer is growing, and or sending a new blood sample to look at circulating cancer or tumor DNA, our hope is that if we better understand resistance in each individual patient, we can develop novel strategies to overcome resistance or to develop even better drugs or drug combinations to help extend the benefit of these therapies even longer.
Thanks so much, Mark, and for all the exciting work that's going in here, and hopefully we'll refine our therapeutic approach. Now, immunotherapy, as I mentioned, is our other mainstay of treatment and does work in a number of individuals, including in some, but not all cancers that have KRAS mutations, but tends not to work as well in cancers that have, for example, the EGFR mutations or some of the other ones where we have these targeted therapies. So I'll turn over to Dave to maybe comment on some of his work and how it's sort of helping us think about why immunotherapies work in some contexts and why it doesn't work in others, and how can we move that forward.
Yeah, thanks, Pasi. So part of the reason it doesn't work as well in, for example, the EGFR mutant cancers is that often patients who have never smoked are enriched for developing these what we call oncogene-addicted tumors, where the targeted therapies work. And it's always been frustrating where we have a great targeted therapy option for those patients, but for our smoker, you know, people who have smoked, I mean, many people have smoked and don't develop lung cancer. We haven't had options, and often the KRAS is often enriched in that context. And as you just heard, we do now have a targeted therapy option. However, the advantage of when there's a lot of mutations that can happen and actually can happen following smoking is that it could make the tumor more foreign. And in fact, there have been associations with high mutations, high mutation rate in response to this immunotherapy. What we're most interested in is this is a disconnect. Why are there cancers that should respond? They have a very high mutation rate, but yet they don't. And there are two emerging classes of these. One of this is small cell lung cancer, and the other is within KRAS mutant lung cancer. You heard about, you can divide it based on the mutation itself, the G12C. But it turns out there's other mutations that can go alongside the KRAS. And there's one that's gained a lot of attention called STK11, because that one, when that's present, it's been very clear that you don't respond to immunotherapy despite having a high level of mutations. And so what our group has been interested in, try to characterize these two tumor types, small cell lung cancer and that KRAS STK11, because there's got to be a mechanism that mediates the resistance. And so we've now described several of these. And once you understand the science behind it, now you can try to reverse this. And that's what we're eagerly working on translating to the clinic.
Thanks so much, David. And we'll look forward to seeing how this plays out in the clinic and how your research is hopefully going to impact the efficacy of immune therapies. I'm gonna, before we welcome our audience's question, I'm gonna shift the gears a little bit in our discussion. We spent most of the time today talking about advancements in the treatment strategies of lung cancer patients. However, disparities persist among our patients in terms of access to therapies, which of course impacts outcome. And I wanted to turn this question over to Chris, if you could talk a little bit about what Dana-Farber has done to address inequities and the results that you've seen from these programs.
Yeah, so I think, thanks Pasi. I think there's as you can see, in all of the work that's being done, there's incredible work that's being done. You know, what we've been focusing on, what my work is also focusing on, is making sure that everybody has equal access. And how do we do this? Well, first, let's talk about the screening. So we have in our cancer care equity program, we've really been focused on federally qualified health centers that are in our communities. They're not licensed health centers that, you know, that we control. This is something that we go in and we work with the individual center directors. And, you know, our team gets in there and our job is to actually help folks get connected to lung cancer screening. And if people do have any concerning nodules, we navigate them directly into the cancer center. And that's a program that we've been doing since 2013. And in addition to that, you know, we've got a couple of other areas that we're working on. So we're looking at, there's a program where we're looking at, there's some data that shows if you do get the next generation sequencing, you're more likely to go on clinical trials. So in some of the work that I do out in our network sites, we actually have a program called Surge. And it's really specifically looking at teaching folks and engaging community folks about the necessity and needs for having genetic testing for your lung cancer, but also navigating them specifically to get the testing. And then what we hope to show is that those folks who are would be on clinical trials. And when we talk about the communities that were that are need access, it's talking about historically marginalized communities by race and class, rural communities as well, and you know, folks who their insurance usually have blocked them from coming in. So those are some of the things that we are working on directly and you know, to try to make sure that all these incredible developments make it to all the people who need them.
Great, thank you so much, Chris. We'll move on to our Q&A session with all of you. And I encourage you to please submit some questions. There were some questions that were submitted during the registration process, and I was going to direct this to Mark and say, are you working on applying discoveries in EGFR mutant non-small cell lung cancer to other oncogene lung cancer types such as ALK and ROS1? And maybe you can address both sort of the next generation targeted therapies and the non-targeted therapeutic approaches that you're working on.
Yeah, I think what is what's been very helpful in lung cancer research over the last several years is trying to learn and adapt from one cancer type and apply it to others. And since our group has trials and has done research on each of these different subtypes of lung cancer that were mentioned, EGFR, ALK, ROS1, MET, BRAF, we've got now a growing list of targeted therapies. We have been able to learn and apply what we know from one type and develop advances in other types. So the EGFR mutant form of lung cancer was the first one for which we had targeted therapies. And by studying and understanding how resistance developed to our first generation of inhibitors, we were able to then develop, and Pasi's lab has been at the forefront of this work, to develop novel combination strategies or new single drugs that can overcome resistance. And those drugs are very potent. They are well tolerated. They can get distributed very well throughout the body, including in the brain. And by development of these improved therapies, they've been able to be moved up into the first line setting as the initial therapy for patients. And they extend the benefit to these inhibitors. We can often see tremendous responses, not only in the body, but in the brain or the central nervous system, which is a big challenge because lung cancer has a tendency to spread to the brain. And through that, we've also been able to develop these advances for ALK and ROS1 positive lung cancers, developing more potent but well-tolerated therapies, ones that get into the central nervous system, ones that overcome resistance to other inhibitors. And through that, I think we have been very fortunate to participate in a number of the trials that have led to further and further approvals for these subtypes of lung cancer. We're, of course, continuing to try to develop better treatments. And also, as Dave Barbie mentioned, you know, some of these subtypes of lung cancer do not benefit currently from immunotherapy. And so we're really trying to understand why that happens and to develop some new immune approaches for each of these subtypes of lung cancer.
Question from the audience. I'll direct this one to Julia. The biggest barrier to introducing new therapies into the clinic is standard therapy.
Yeah, and that's always something we think about quite a bit because we see patients in clinic. We know our patients need their next treatment option and they don't have time to wait months and years for the next therapies. I think it weighs on all of our mind as well. How can we quickly but safely bring these treatments to patients or bring new ideas to patients? My first thought on that is it makes it also more important to have as many patients as possible have access to clinical trials. So when it comes to issues of equitable access to care, access to academic consultation, if patients aren't seen, we can't get these options to them. And if it takes a while to become a standard treatment that's available off the shelf, we want to get patients in on clinical trial whenever possible. The other thing is that getting that testing done, things like gene sequencing, so we know what targets are there and can try to identify options for patients beyond standard treatment. But if we don't get the testing, we may not know. So getting that testing for as many patients as possible, again, becomes critical. And I think collaboration with the FDA and with biotechnology companies, when we think about things like breakthrough therapy designation, really be able to pinpoint therapies that are very promising in studies to try to move them through the regulatory process and get them out more widely as quickly as possible. They're all critical features.
Maybe you can answer a question on mesothelioma do the therapeutic approaches that we've talked about work on mesothelioma? And if so, or if not, why not? And what's being done there?
Sure. Yeah. Traditionally, targeted therapies have not worked as well for pleural mesothelioma. Immunotherapy is working, but in a pretty small subset. And in part, that is very similar to what I mentioned. There aren't necessarily a lot of the mutations that you find in, say, someone who's smoked. But what's interesting, and again, something we're particularly interested in is, again, why in small cell lung cancer does the immunotherapy only work a fraction of the time? And same thing with mesothelioma. And we think there are different mechanisms. But one of the exciting areas is what Pasi started to mention about CAR therapy, that mesotheliomas express a target. Mesothelin, for which there are these engineered receptors that you can put on so-called T cells or CAR NK cells and infuse into patients and really kind of hijack this artificial immune cell to start attacking the cancer. And so that's work being done in other places and work that we're increasingly showing proof of principle data for as well.
And I will say this, we had an approval of a combination immunotherapy for mesothelioma this past year with two types of immune therapies that are given together. So there is definitely progress. And again, that was through a clinical trial that showed that there was an overall benefit of that. Chris, there's a question about, collaborations with, how do Dana-Farber oncologists collaborate with local oncologists? This was about a specific geographic area, but do you want to maybe describe a little bit about sort of our network and affiliates and kind of where it extends to and how we work with different sites?
Yeah, so I think one of the areas about that's been great that I've been very involved in over the years is our Dana-Farber network. So if we think about the Longwood area as our central campus, we have long had five and now we're going to have six different sites. So there is a these are usually general oncologists. Some of them will have some subspecialization. So you might have a general oncologist, you might be specialized a little bit in lung and head and neck, and also do some benign hematology, for example. And these are practices that are owned and licensed by the Dana-Farber. So it's not just some collaborative relationships. These are people that we hire and they have direct access to our center and actually can refer people in for some trials. And some of the trials we can actually do in the centers themselves and in these other sites. So there is a site in Milford, there's a site in Weymouth, and those are our largest sites. Then we have a site in Methuen, in Lawrence Methuen, that's our Merrimack Valley site. There is a site in Brighton at St. Elizabeth's. There is a site in Londonderry, and also they'll be opening a brand new site in August in Foxborough. So these are areas where, the idea is to have local folks, refer patients in for their cancers, and, almost 100% of the patients that are seen initially in these sites stay in the Dana-Farber system. And then we have a whole bunch of integration efforts to make sure that if these patients need a clinical trial, if they want to get to some of the subspecialty expertise that we have, that they're able to do that as well. And I myself have been having a clinic in one of these sites as, and have been a medical director there, and that's been what we're pushing, the integration. So this is a good opportunity to extend all the great things that we do. And actually, Dr. Barbie and I have a collaboration with one of the surgeons at that at one of these other sites. And we, you know, just working on bench research and helping with the bench research as well. So this is really what we want to do and continue to expand access.
Thanks, Chris. A question that I'll direct to Mark relates to sort of individual variation among people. So, you know, Mark, two patients that have the same genetic alteration but respond differently or for different periods of time, what... How do you look at that, or how do you think about that?
Yeah, this is a real question and a real challenge and a mystery, frankly, for what we see in clinic every day. You know, for, as you said, Pasi, you know, some patients can have the same exact mutation and we start the same drug at the same dose and we see variation or differences in outcomes. And in one case, we might see a good response, but it's more shorter lived in that the cancer starts to grow, say, you know, 9 months after treatment has been started. And in other patients, we see very long-term durable responses where they're on the same drug and they haven't needed to make any changes 3, 4, 5, 6 years later. Same with immunotherapy. We really have been trying to understand the mechanisms of response and also the mechanisms of resistance to these treatments. We have some biomarkers that we're trying to identify to really help understand and stratify outcomes and what we observe in clinic. But right now, I think for some of our targeted therapies like EGFR, ALK, ROS1, BRAF, et cetera, we really don't have a great sense of why we're seeing these differences. And that is a strong area of research in our group. There's been a lot of effort to either look at baseline factors, either something about the patients themselves, the immune systems, or something about the cancer and the different mutations or features about the cancer that might predict for longer term versus shorter term benefit. Some of the work that's going on in the laboratories focusing on this question of persister cells. So we can see, you know, dramatic shrinkages of cancer with therapy, but if you don't kill 100% of the cancer cells, if you kill 99.9%, you know, I think we're trying to understand why is that 0.1% of cancer cells still viable or still resistant to therapy. So these are really important questions for us. And hopefully if we can answer some of these questions, we'll be able to really extend the benefit of therapy for more of our patients.
Yeah, I will just add that we'd like to also get to the point where we'd be able to predict or have some understanding of who is going to have a longer versus a shorter benefit, because we have, you know, therapeutic combinations or more intensified therapies that we would be able to deploy in a situation that we would, you know, if we were able to say that a single drug wouldn't be as beneficial or for as long, and that would be helpful for the individual. So definitely an active area for us to do these kinds of things, and also to study this what's called the persister state that that Mark mentioned, you know, so the following the initial response to treatment, the sort of the residual cells that remain that can be sort of the nidus for subsequent resistance to develop. How can we eliminate those and prevent them from turning into resistant forms of cancer? So definitely an area of focus for us. a question for David. There's a couple of questions on sort of what are the next steps for immunotherapy, progress on immunotherapy, besides our checkpoint inhibitors? Where do we go next, or what's next on the horizon?
Yeah, and I think just because I talked a lot about the resistance to the immunotherapy, I think also the very fact that we are seeing quite incredible response. I think there was one question during registration sort of about, can the cancer cells ever completely resolve with immunotherapy, or is surgery needed? And even with just the immune checkpoint inhibitors alone, these are the PD-1, that even in stage 4, I think what's been quite remarkable is, whereas we've talked a lot about acquired resistance to the targeted therapies, that we do believe that for the first time, we're actually seeing cures of stage 4 patients. And again, our goal is to figure out why isn't that happening to everybody? Why can't we kind of what we call increase this long-term survival, the tail of the curve even further. But I think, you know, beyond the anti-PD-1, that's one of the what we call checkpoints. There are other checkpoints. My analogy is like these are the force field that the tumor is putting up to shield itself, and the PD-L1 is one of those force fields. But there are other ones, something called, in addition to what you may have heard of CTLA-4, but something called LAG-3, TIGIT, a variety. Unfortunately, those aren't so far. There was a kind of another disappointing outcome that was just reported for one of those. And I think part of the challenge is the precision that we need to tailor those additional combinations to individual patients. So I think that's where a lot of the current research is. And then, as I mentioned, the CAR therapies are really generating steam. And then I think ultimately what's needed are T cells attacking the tumor and figuring out what are the actual, what we call the antigens, the tumor's actually displaying that those T cells are recognizing. So there's a lot of effort trying to figure out, because you could then vaccinate against those antigens to really boost the response.
I might just also add to David's comments that we're also now using immunotherapy earlier on in the course of lung cancer. So as we mentioned, the immunotherapies were initially approved just for stage 4 metastatic lung cancer, and then were approved for a form of stage 3 lung cancer that's not amenable to surgery. But now our hope is through earlier and earlier detection, which again is a major goal for cancer care. Now we're seeing more early stage lung cancer, and we've seen the first approvals within this past year of using immunotherapy either after surgery or now before surgery in what's called adjuvant or neoadjuvant therapies. And we hope that that is also increasing the cure and preventing the cancers from coming back. So I think there are major advances for our standard immunotherapies, but as David said, we definitely need novel immune targeting strategies to help additional patients that may not respond to our currently approved drugs.
Thanks, Mark. There's a question in the chat about how we coordinate, or is our research coordinated with other centers like Memorial and MD Anderson? And I would say yes. We, of course, do this in multiple different ways, either through doing clinical trials together, where we all are able to enroll patients into specific trials, because not any one center may have patients with one of those rare genetic subsets, for example, or specific features that is required for the trial entry. And so we work together in that capacity. But we work together also in grants and large programs and do research collaborative efforts together in that capacity as well. So definitely we do coordinate and work together with other cancer centers. And we all have the same goal. Whether we're at Dana-Farber or other centers and collectively work on the same goal. I don't know if Dave, you want to comment on that, since you've participated and worked on collaborative grants and are now going to lead, along with Dr. Sequist at MGH, leading our lung cancer SPORE grant, which we got a very good score on and likely be funded. So
yeah, so there some of this is catalyzed, sorry. So this is catalyzed by foundations like Stand Up to Cancer, and I've been part of that with Pasi, and that's directly, we have a project with MD Anderson as part of that on the KRAS STK11 project that I mentioned, but there are also NIH mechanisms called SPORE grants, and we're very happy to say that through a very strong collaborative effort with MGH, we're going to be awarded one of these SPORE grants, which not only fosters very strong collaboration within Boston around 3 main projects centered around EGFR, ALK, and ALK immunotherapy and KRAS, but also with other institutions that have SPORE. So there's a Texas SPORE that includes MD Anderson and UT Southwestern. The Hutch has a SPORE and Emory. And so there's very direct collaboration that's built in interinstitutional across the country as well.
Great, thank you. So I will turn it over to Bill for his closing remarks. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Pasi. As we conclude today, I'd like to add my personal thanks to our expert panel. Pasi, of course, Mark, David, Julia, Chris, We appreciate the time that you've shared with us today and for the work that you do every day. As many of you have likely heard, Dana-Farber is in the middle of a Dana-Farber campaign, a $2 billion fundraising campaign with the goal of harnessing new techniques and technologies to prevent, treat, and defy cancer. Today, you heard about how Dana-Farber's scientific discoveries continue to drive advances in cancer care, resulting in more lives saved and more families intact. But you also heard that there is more work to be done to ensure that there are effective treatment options and new ways to prevent every type of cancer. Philanthropy is critical to keeping Dana-Farber's foot on the accelerator, equipping those that you heard from today with the resources they need to provide first-rate care and to pursue innovative studies for the patients and families that are counting on us. We hope that you'll consider joining us. If you'd like to learn more, you can use the QR code that's on the screen now to visit our website, defycancer.org, or you can email Patty Brent from the Office of Philanthropy directly, and her information is provided in the chat. The next webinar in our Behind the Breakthrough series will be held on June 8th, and will highlight Dana-Farber's Center for BRCA and Related Genes. And you will get an email with the recording of today's program, along with a link to register for upcoming webinars. And finally, a survey will pop up at the conclusion of this webinar. Please consider filling it out, as your feedback helps us shape future Behind the Breakthroughs programs. Thank you all for joining us today. Be well.